Hi, I'm Mike Clark. Thanks for clicking on to WTAE.com and checking out our papal visit page. You know, it took more than 78 years, but Pope Francis is finally visiting the U.S. Cardinal Donald Wuerl, the Archbishop of Washington, D.C., is the Pope's American host welcoming the Holy Father to the U.S. Cardinal Wuerl served as the Bishop of Pittsburgh for 18 years before moving to D.C. Part of the College of Cardinals who elected Pope Francis, Cardinal Wuerl has become one of the Pope's closest advisors. I sat down with a Mount Washington native who shared his thoughts on the two-year pontificate of Pope Francis, reflecting on what this visit to the U.S. means for the Catholic Church and for the country.
To be able to welcome him, to be able to stand there and welcome him from the plane onto the soil of America, for me that's a great, great privilege. But what adds to it is the fact that he is coming as this truly beloved shepherd. There's a lot of anticipation. There was a huge amount of preparation. But somehow that all fades away when you see this smiling countenance actually coming into the midst of all of us. The preparation has been enormous, it's been long, it's been detailed, and that's the way it should be. This is the Vicar of Christ coming among us.
Not bad for a kid from Mount Washington.
Not bad at all, and who would have ever thought, growing up in Mount Washington and going to St. Mary's Parish and St. Mary of the Mount School, who would have ever thought? My horizons then were basically, and now I'm dating myself, but were basically Forbes Field, as the furthest extent to which you could get in the city on trolley. And now it's...
frequent flyers.
It's frequent flyers mounting up considerably. I see my primary responsibility as reflecting the experience of the church here in our country, our pastoral ministry. What is our experience of living out the gospel, of loving the Lord, and trying to serve his people? I would like him to come away with the realization, yes, there are challenges. Yes, this is a very secular culture. Yes, we're having to struggle to be able to see clearly what Christ is offering us. But there's a lot of life and a lot of faith in this church. One of the things that I hope he sees as he spends his time with us, as he moves around, I hope he sees the vibrancy of the church and also its youth. We as a church here in our country, and particularly in Washington, where I have the privilege of serving, but it's true in Pittsburgh, where I had the privilege of serving for 18 years, there's a lot of energy, there's a lot of faith. There's a lot of life and vitality, and you see it reflected in many, many young people, young adults. It's one of the things we're so proud of in Washington, and he'll have a chance to see that in Washington, our new seminary. The St. John Paul II Seminary that I started 5 years ago, it's filled. I think at the heart of his message is going to be something he's been saying from the very beginning, that we have to remember, even in our personal failure, and this would go even institutionally as a nation, God loves each one of us. And we're never that far from God if we simply let him into our lives. I think that's his message. He's coming as a pastor, not a politician. He's coming as a pastor of souls, not a director of policy. And so his message is going to be a message for everyone. And I think the reason it'll be so well received is he has a way of making everyone feel they're welcome. All over this country there are young people, and because of the freedom in this country, we can aspire to be whatever we would like to be. And I hope he'll realize and see all of the layers of activity that make this country great. We are not a state where the government does everything. We're a country where people come together and they do this, whether it's community organizations, of which there are so many, whether it's churches, synagogues, faith communities, doing all these good things, whether it's a fraternal organization or a union or a sodality. We have all of these great organizations bringing people together to do, out of our freedom, out of our faith, out of our love for one another, good things for everybody. He will go from addressing the joint meeting of Congress to our Catholic Charities Center, and will meet with some of our clients, homeless, street people, people that we provide meals for. He'll have a chance to see the trailer that provides every evening food for these people, good people who just need help, the poor. And it'll be a visible reminder. I don't know what he'll say, but the contrast between the Chamber of Congress and the homeless on the street being fed should be pretty strong. He will be a voice for peace. But today, we have to do two things, it seems to me, if we're going to have peace. We have to recognize the religious freedom of everyone. So you can't have what's going on in Syria, Iraq, Nigeria, India, Sudan. You can't have people being slaughtered because of their faith conviction. There is going to have to be a recognition of religious freedom. But secondly, there's going to have to be a recognition that social development is the way to peace, and that economic development drives social development, but it has to be mindful of the dignity of people and the environment. We have to treat this earth with care. We have to treat this earth with reverence if it's going to be able to sustain life well into the future. Whatever development takes place, and we need social development, and we need economic development, but it has to be done respectfully of everything around us, human beings and their dignity, and Mother Earth, God's creation. I hope the afterglow of the departure of our Holy Father will be a realization that what he said is true, that there will be this renewed sense of goodwill, an openness to one another, and a willingness to work together to do the things that we're capable of doing. Imagine what it would be like if all the anticipation that centered on his being such a welcoming Pope, if all of that were confirmed in a way that we simply said as a people, as Americans all over this country, why can't we live in peace? Why can't we do things together? Why can't we build a truly good and just society? Why can't we respect one another? Why can't we care for the environment? And the answer should be, we can. We just have to do it